following lecture was produced by Glorian Publishing, a nonprofit organization, and is one of hundreds of lectures freely available via download, podcasts, streaming radio, and transcription. These lectures range in topic and complexity in order to address the many needs of humanity. We invite you to browse our library of lectures, books, courses, and articles to find teachings that suit you. Through the support of donations, Glorian Publishing has published 40 books, hosts international retreats several times a year, offers free online courses, and many other valuable resources, available to anyone worldwide. All of this has been made possible by the financial support of listeners like you. Your donations make it possible for this free public service to reach thousands of people every day. To make a tax-deductible donation in any amount, even anonymously, visit GnosticTeachings.org. Now, with heartfelt wishes for the end of suffering for all creatures, we begin the lecture. May all beings be happy.
In Hinduism, there are two primary stories that reflect the central interest of the population, of the devotees of the Lord. We find throughout Southeast Asia, Nepal, India, Burma, Cambodia, Laos, Thailand, Malaysia, Indonesia, and the surrounding countries, that the main cosmic drama that tells the story of spirituality and the potential of the human being is encapsulated or encoded in the Ramayana. The Ramayana is an epic poem that has strong similarities to the Western Odyssey and Iliad, written by Homer. The Ramayana is the story of Ramachandra, often just called Rama, who is a great hero, worshipped as God on earth, who accomplished many great tasks for the benefit of humanity. It would not be possible in a single lecture to explain the Ramayana. It would be somewhat like trying to explain the Bible in one lecture. It would not be possible to tell the story of Rama in one lecture. It would be like trying to tell the story of Jesus. There are many details, many anecdotes, and many subtleties in the story of Rama or Ramachandra. So our purpose in this lecture is not to explain in detail the story of the Ramayana or the life of Rama, but instead to give you the clues so that you can understand the real importance of the story. So that when you do study it, you will understand that it is not a literal history. It is a cosmic drama. In the same way that the Gospels of Jesus explain a cosmic drama, or the Odyssey is a cosmic drama. And all the great epic poems and scriptures are really cosmic dramas that reflect the same story. The story of a solar hero, a hero related to the sun, who overcomes obstacles for the benefit of others. This is the story of the Ramayana. This first image shows you in the very middle Ramachandra. He's also called Lord Rama. You'll note that he has distinctive characteristics. So if you ever look at Indian artwork, there are two fundamental signs that tell you you're looking at Rama. One is his blue skin. And if you've been paying attention, you'll remember that the first lecture about Krishna was also about a blue-skinned hero. Rama also has blue skin. His other distinctive characteristic is his bow. which is part of a critical part of the story of his development. And on either side are his wife and his brother. This particular image is a detail out of a larger image where you see his other brothers gathered with him. But Rama, in the story of the Ramayana, although Rama is worshipped as God, as an exponent of God, we have to remember that Hinduism, although it presents a polytheistic face, is not really polytheism in the way that the Westerners define it. Because the Hindus know that every image of God, every face of God, every parsuf, in Hebrew terms, is the same God. So in the previous lecture, we talked about polytheistic monism, which is a description of the Gnostic tradition, but also of Hinduism. It's a tradition that studies the many facets or faces that God uses to aid us, to help us. And Rama is one of those faces. The true devotee of Hinduism or any multifaceted religion knows that in their worship of a deity, even if they pick a name and face to represent that deity, it is one God. Rama is Krishna. Rama is Shiva. Is Brahma, is Vishnu. Rama is Jehovah. Rama is God. But specifically, the Ramayana tells how God incarnates on earth. And this is a very important story for humanity, because it explains what spirituality really means. Really. That spirituality is not just about worshiping a distant idea. Religion is not really on earth, present on earth, for us to just respect it. Religion has been brought to us from age to age so that we will embody it, so that we become God. And that's what the story of Rama represents, how God comes to live in us, in the same way that the story of Jesus represents that, how God comes to live through us. We can understand this very clearly when we study these scriptures in relation with Kabbalah. This image shows the tree of life, which of course is known mostly as a Western symbol. It shows 10 spheres organized in 3 columns and 3 triangles. These 10 spheres have many levels of meaning. They represent the cosmos, the universe, the multiplicity of levels of existence, not just physical, but many dimensions. So this glyph or map represents the universe outside of us. But it also represents how we are a reflection of that universe, and everything that is in the external universe is reflected in us spiritually. We have a physical dimension, which is our body. But just as there is a fourth dimension in the universe, we have a fourth dimension in us, and that is Yasod. So the bottommost sphere relates to our physical aspect, the physical world, and our physical body. And the one just above that is the fourth dimensional aspect of us and the outside. And likewise, as we move up these spheres, we find 7 fundamental dimensions in nature. 10 spheres that are organized to represent 7 dimensions. At the top of this tree, we have a fundamental trinity, which is present in every religion. And we explained this in the first few lectures of this course. This trinity at the top represents the 3 forces that implement all creation, preservation, and destruction. The movement of any energy in nature is a movement of 3 forces that work together. In Hinduism, those 3 forces are represented as Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva, which we see at the top. In Christianity, they're called the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. In Kabbalah, they are Keter, Chokmah, and Binah. This trinity is the fundamental fountainhead from which creation emerges. It is a great, subtle, all-powerful law in nature. All creation, all preservation, and all destruction are maintained and perpetuated by these three forces that work together. But in any phase of creation, preservation, or destruction, one of these three takes dominance. In a creative phase, the first force is dominant. In a preserving phase, the second force is dominant. In a destructive phase, the third force is dominant. We find this very subtle in the way nature functions. And it gets difficult to understand because for all of these three forces to operate, they work through the third force, which is symbolized as Shiva in Hinduism. That third force is what propels that energy in activity in nature. It's subtle. It's difficult to grasp. It has to be followed intuitively. What's important to understand here is that these images of gods are symbolic of forces that work in the universe outside of us and the universe inside of us. These three together are the light of life. They are what in Egyptian mythology is called Amun-Ra, the solar father, the sun at the heart of any system of living things. In the Greek mythology, we call it Christus, Christ, life, light, Ahura Mazda. You can call it Allah. You can call it Adi Buddha or Adi Shakti. There are many names for this force that emerges at the base of existence. Through the course of our evolution as a humanity, we go through many ups and downs, phases of golden ages and phases of dark ages. And throughout those periods of development, our guides, those who have advanced beyond our level, always make the effort to aid us, to help preserve us in our times of darkness. In order for us to be preserved, to be saved from ourselves, we need a force of preservation, of protection. And that force emerges from the second sphere. In Hinduism, it's called Vishnu. Vishnu is represented as a great deity, a great god, but that's a symbol of a force in nature, an intelligence, a wisdom, a type of knowledge, a type of intelligence that's far beyond anything that we can comprehend with our puny brain. Vishnu is this aspect of divinity that loves us purely and wants to protect us and help us. So in dark times, that force descends into the world in order to aid us. Jesus is an exponent of Vishnu, a manifestation of that force. In this case, we'd say, as I explained, the second sphere, which is called the sun in Christianity, is Christ, particularized in order to descend into lower levels to help us. This is why in Hinduism, we see that Vishnu is depicted as having 10 avatars. Avatar is merely a messenger. An avatar is an expression of something divine. An avatar is like a mailman. who delivers a message. The avatar is just the vehicle through which the message is given. The mailman doesn't really matter that much. What matters is the message. Unfortunately, humanity gets confused and worships the mailman instead of reading the message and studying the message and embodying the message. Vishnu, as the preserving force, as that Christic expression of love for humanity, descends into nature in order to preserve our potential to reach Him. The preserving force of Chokmah has this impulse to preserve our future, to preserve our happiness, to preserve our souls. So Vishnu expresses through avatars, messengers, in order to do this. To understand how that works, we need to understand the qualities of Vishnu and what's expected or required of a genuine avatar in order to embody and express the light of Christ. As we explained in the first lecture in this course, Vishnu represents the beautiful polytheistic monism of God. In other words, the many faces that the one God can take, that one light at the base of living will utilize in order to help others, to help us. This painting represents that. That the one being that we call God, the divine, Allah, or Buddha, utilizes many expressions in order to best reach our psychology, in order to best penetrate our heart and guide us, and utilizes any means necessary in order to preserve our soul and save us from ourselves. As such, Vishnu is said to have six fundamental qualities. There are more, but there are six important qualities related to this aspect of God, of divinity. The first one is said to be jnana. Jnana is roughly translated means knowledge, but it doesn't have anything to do with book knowledge. The Greek equivalent of this term is gnosis. And you see, even in the way they're written, spelled, pronounced, there's a similarity. Nya is the beginning of both of these terms. That nya means to know. But it is not knowledge in the intellect. It is knowledge in the consciousness. It is to know from experience. It is to know for oneself because one has done it. One has experienced it. Vishnu is the very embodiment of gnosis, knowledge. Vishnu is Christ. And the Gnostic tradition is a Christic tradition. We teach the path to reach Christ 100%. This means that the Gnostic teaching is different from most other teachings that you'll encounter in the world for several reasons. But the one that I want to emphasize today is that the Gnostic tradition is related to the higher aspect of the three types of schools. We have foundational level schools, we have the middle level, or what we could call esoteric, or mesoteric rather, and then we have the advanced levels, which we would call esoteric. In Buddhism, these are called Sutrayana, as the foundational level. The middle level is called Mahayana. And the third level is called Tantrayana. The difference between these three groups is how far they can take you. And in order to enter into each level, one has to earn it and be prepared to take advantage of it. Not everyone does so. But the point I'm trying to reach, these three levels are explained in many other lectures that we've given, so you can look those up. Within the top level, the Tantrayana level, which has its correspondences in every religion in the world, within that group, there's a small number of people who have awakened enough consciousness and purified enough of themselves that they can enter into an even more distinct path. So what we can say is, people who are really serious about their spirituality, not just theories, not just beliefs, but actually working on themselves daily to purify themselves of impurities and to learn about real virtue and act on virtue, we can say those people become candidates for the spiral path. The spiral path means it's a path that's ascending up to higher levels of spiritual purity, but it's gradual. It moves slowly. It has certain requirements in order to enter into the first levels, which we don't have time to get into today. The basic requirements are 5 initiations related to the soul. These are not given in the physical world. They're given in the internal worlds. These 5 initiations cannot be skipped. They cannot be avoided. Every soul who seeks to become a Buddha or an angel or a master passes through these initiations, and the requirements are extremely strict. Those who pass those 5 can then enter into the straight path. That straight path is related to that small group of people who exit Tantrayana to go beyond that. The straight path is the path of the bodhisattva. Not just the theory of the bodhisattva, but the embodiment of it. In the Hindu and Buddhist teachings, throughout these introductory levels, foundational levels, middle levels, and advanced levels, everyone studies bodhisattvas. And in the Mahayana level, or mesoteric level, they begin to learn about how to practice as a bodhisattva, and what being a bodhisattva means, and how to start living that way. But when I talk about the straight path, I'm not talking about the idea of bodhisattvas or trying to emulate bodhisattvas. It is when one becomes a bodhisattva. So what is that? What is a bodhisattva? This term is very deep in its implications. But what it really means, it has 2 components, bodhi and sattva. Do you remember the 3 gunas that I explained in the first few lectures? The 3 gunas are the 3 modalities of nature. Gunas are vibrations or modifications of the base prakriti. So we talk about Triguna Maya Shakti. And this is the base foundational level of nature as the Divine Mother, who particularizes into forms of energy in order for nature to exist. And there are 3 primary forms: Rajas, Tamas, and Sattva. Here we see Sattva. Sattva is one of those base gunas. It is a very deep, profound level of energy in nature. So sattva can also be translated as embodiment of, essence of, condensation of, or expression of. Bodhi means wisdom. So a bodhisattva, literally translated, means embodiment of wisdom. But let's look at this in relation with what we're studying in Hinduism. When we look at the tree of life, we see each of these 10 spheres has a name in Hebrew. The sphere related with Vishnu in Hinduism, in Hebrew, is called wisdom. Chokmah. Chokmah in Hebrew means wisdom. So a bodhisattva is an incarnation of wisdom, an embodiment of Vishnu. This means that a real bodhisattva, no matter what tradition they come from in the world, what religion, what type of body, what type of skin, what type of language, any true bodhisattva is an incarnation of Vishnu, is an avatar at a certain level. There are many types of avatars, not just one kind. Any messenger who delivers the teaching of Vishnu is an avatar at their level. But there are also Maha avatars, like Krishna or Rama. A bodhisattva is one who has direct knowledge of all of that. They have jnana. They have the jnana, the knowledge, the gnosis of Christ that expresses through their words, through their actions, through how they live. In other words, what they do is gnosis. Not just what they say, what they do. A true bodhisattva is an expression of Christ. In other words, there is no I. There is no self. There is no self-concern. There is no self-interest. There is only interest in suffering people, in trying to help those who suffer. So a true bodhisattva is like Jesus, Rama, or Krishna. Every action they perform is for the benefit of others, not themselves. That is jnana, that is the knowledge of Vishnu. The second quality of Vishnu is Aishvara. This term Aishvara comes from Ishvara, which is a Sanskrit word that means master or lord. Ishvara is related with your own innermost. It's related with the real master. And that real master is not a terrestrial person. It is God. As the Bible says, we only have one master, that is Christ. Vishnu is that. The master of masters. The Christ. Aishvara means embodiment of that. It is to be the full mastery of a master. The third quality of Vishnu is Shakti. We explained Shakti in the first two lectures, especially the second one about the Divine Mother. Shakti is often translated as energy, but really it means power. Anything you want to do in life, whether materially or spiritually, you need power. Not electricity, but the power to act, the power to do. We don't have that. We lack power in life. Truly, we are powerless. The small amount of free will we have is so bound by karma, by circumstances, by conditions. We are very limited in what we are able to do in our lives. Vishnu is not bound by anything but the root laws of nature, which are karma, cause and effect, and the motion of the three gunas. But that Shakti is the energy of the Divine Mother, nature, that Vishnu modifies and utilizes. Remember, Vishnu is not just a masculine god. Vishnu is Lakshmi, the goddess who provides and preserves. That is the energy or the power of Vishnu. The fourth quality of Vishnu is Bala. Bala means strength. And this is not just to have big muscles. This is a strength of consciousness. And that strength refers directly to willpower. It is the strength to persist, the strength to preserve. Vishnu is the second force, as Chokmah is the preserver, the one who protects. And that bala, or that strength of Vishnu, is the strength to protect the ones he loves. And that's us. Not a single person on this planet, with the single exception of those who have fully awakened, has comprehended how much God is protecting them from moment to moment. We are all so asleep, we have no idea of how much effort our own inner being makes to protect us from ourselves. Our inner being uses all of his bala, his strength, to protect us from our own karma. And we have no idea how many times we've almost lost our lives or lost our minds because of our karma, because of our bad habits, because of our ignorance and our desire. And it's Vishnu in us, the force of Vishnu working through our innermost, who protects us and preserves us and is continuing to give us an opportunity to change. That is related with bala. The fifth is virya. Virya is a very important word, especially in Tantra. The word virya is the root of the English word virility. It means to have strength, energy, power. So you see, it's related with Shakti and Bala. Really, virya is where we have all of the other qualities moving into action. Virya is also the root of the word virtue. It is also where we see in the name of Vishnu that V is the same as in virya. Virya is the virility of the divine, the power of creation. It is a sexual power, but one that God harnesses not for lust or desire, but to create spiritually. The sixth quality is tejas. Again, we see a modality of nature. Tejas, strictly translated, means fire. And oftentimes we talk about this as one of the elements in nature related with earth, air, water, and fire, or a tattva, which is a vibration of ether or akash. But as a quality of Vishnu, it's far beyond any tattva. Tejas here means splendor, radiance. It's that light that emerges from a fire. It isn't merely a tattva. Tattvas are far below Vishnu. Tejas, in this case, represents the luminosity of God, that light that irradiates from Christ. Tejas is the luminance that awakens the consciousness, that opens the mind, that stimulates the heart, that scatters the demons. And all of that is a power of Vishnu. Now, studying these six qualities, now you can start to comprehend what a bodhisattva is. A bodhisattva is an expression of these six qualities. A bodhisattva is someone who demonstrates the jnana of Vishnu, who is a master of themselves, an Ishvara, and who worships and respects their inner master, and is not blinded or confused by any external circumstances like personalities, politics, groups, all of that. They only follow their innermost. They have Shakti, or power. They have Bala, or strength, willpower. They have Virya, great energy and vitality. And they have Tejas, luminosity, radiance. But the defining characteristic of all six of these qualities is selflessness. All of these qualities of Vishnu are focused on our benefit, not the bodhisattva. What we often explain in order to understand what a bodhisattva is just a light bulb. When we turn on a light bulb, we're not doing it to look at the light bulb or to be impressed by the light bulb or worship the light bulb. We turn on that light bulb to have light, to see our environment, so we don't get hurt, so we can do what we need to do. That is what a genuine bodhisattva does. They provide light to others, not for themselves, but to protect and preserve others as an expression of Vishnu. Understanding that, we see in Hinduism that traditionally Vishnu is said to have 10 avatars. 9 of those are related with the past events, and 1 is what they call a future avatar. One of those avatars we've already described in the first lecture of this course, which is Krishna, and we see in the upper left-hand corner, Krishna playing his flute. Today's lecture is focused on Rama, which is directly above Vishnu's head in this particular image. And we see the other avatars here. These avatars are literal masters that walked the earth. But moreover, more importantly, they are archetypes. They represent qualities of consciousness that we have to develop. Jesus is an actual master who's still alive, who's still teaching and guiding humanity. But he also represents an archetype. In other words, an aspect of our own consciousness that we need to develop. Krishna is the same, an actual master, but also represents an archetype. In these lectures, we don't focus on the physical person. We respect the masters. We follow their guidance, their teachings. But what we really need to do is become like them. So we need to embody their example and develop those archetypes in ourselves. Rama is no different. Rama is an archetype. So the story of Rama, as told in the Ramayana, is very beautiful, very long, very epic. It's a very popular story throughout Southeast Asia. The story begins with a certain king, Dasaratha, who is in charge of a great kingdom. But he has a problem in that he has no heir, no son to carry on his accomplishments. So the story begins with him wanting to have a son. So what I'm going to do now is read to you a short paragraph that was written by Swami Sivananda that synthesizes the first opening section of the Ramayana so we can understand what's happening here. Sivananda said, "The gods, the Gandharvas, Siddhas, and holy rishis approached Brahma and said, 'O venerable Lord, the demon Ravana is harassing us in various ways through his power. On account of your boon to him, we are not able to check him. Please protect us.' In the meanwhile, Lord Hari arrived. He said to the gods, 'O gods, be not afraid. I shall incarnate on earth to protect you all and destroy the wicked Ravana.' Lord Vishnu divided himself into 4 portions and chose King Dasaratha for his father." So that little description sets up the narrative of the entire Ramayana, the entire epic poem. But this drama is not literal. It has a spiritual message related to how a bodhisattva is incarnated in a spiritual aspirant. What we see here is the very beginning that the holy beings, the Gandharvas, which are holy, sacred, celestial musicians, the Siddhas, which are great yogis, and the holy rishis, which are knowledgeable spiritual aspirants, approach Brahma. Brahma represents Keter, the father, the first sphere on the tree of life. And they said, "Help us, this demon Ravana is afflicting us. We can't do what we need to do." Brahma is Keter, the magician, the first arcanum. And in order for him to work, he needs to unfold himself. So who steps in is Lord Hari. Hari is another name for Vishnu. Vishnu is the second force, the one who steps in to preserve his people. And he says, "Don't worry, I'll incarnate on earth in order to deal with this demon." Now, what this first opening scene also says is that the gods cannot conquer Ravana. Why is that? You would think that a god would have more power than a demon. And that if a demon was causing a problem, God could just throw a thunderbolt and turn him to dust. But the gods have no power over the demon. Interesting. And the reason for this, we're going to explain in a moment when we talk about Ravana. What's explained here is that, well, you know what, I'm going to go ahead and tell you about Ravana, because you'll understand it better if you understand this. Ravana in the past was also a great king. King of Lanka, which is an island off the coast of India. And there is an actual person named Ravana who was a king of Lanka many years ago. But in this story, Ravana is not that person. Ravana is a symbol about something about us. So in the past, this character or element in the story, Ravana, was a great king who was a great devotee of Brahma, the father, and spent countless ages worshiping Brahma with such great power that he impressed Brahma terribly. So much power, he'd sacrificed himself again and again and again. And through the course of all these sacrifices, he gained 10 heads. He became a 10-headed being with so much knowledge that it couldn't fit into one head. So he was given 10 heads. But unfortunately, well, actually, in relation with that, he received a gift from Brahma. Brahma said, "You are my greatest devotee. What can I offer you?" And Ravana said, "Give me immortality." And Brahma said, "I can't give you that. But what I can give you is the guarantee that no god and no spirit and no demon can ever kill you." So Ravana thought that was great. Unfortunately, after that, he fell. He became very arrogant because of his great knowledge and great power, such that he approached the gods and threatened them. He even lifted up their mountain, which is equivalent to Olympus, lifted up the mountain of the gods and shook them. And so the gods said, "No, no, you can't do that." And they pushed down on the mountain, crushing him. And he gave out such a howl, a scream of pain, that he earned his name, Ravana, which means one who screams. So Ravana was once very high, and he fell and became a great demon. So he was afflicting the gods. The gods said, "Help us." And Vishnu said, "I will descend on the earth in order to help you." And he chose King Dasaratha as his father. Now, I'm going to read you the next little portion so we can advance in this story. King Dasaratha, who was endowed with good fortune, who was devoted to truth, and who was very brave and famous, was without a son. He was very much troubled in his heart. He approached his family preceptor, Vasishta, and said, "Oh, my venerable master, I have no issue to carry on the line. I am troubled with the sorrow of being childless." So Vasishta said, "O righteous king, you will beget 4 mighty sons. Bring Risha Shringa, perform at once the sacrifice called Putra Kamesti." So Dasaratha brought the Rishi to Ayodhya, which is his kingdom, and performed the sacrifice. And in this sacrifice, the king of fire appears. The god of fire, rather. And he gives a golden vessel to Dasaratha and says, "O best of kings, take this payasa made by the gods in heaven. Give it to your worthy wives. You shall beget by them mighty sons." So, what does all this mean? First, we need to understand who is King Dasaratha. If we were to read this story literally, we would take what billions of people have taken from this story, which is that the king Dasaratha was an actual king who lived thousands of years ago, somewhere in Asia. And this is true. There is an actual king. But that's not why the story was written. King Dasaratha, the name literally means he who has 10 chariots. Now, I don't know about you, but I think a king that only has 10 chariots would be a pretty poor king. Seems to me that's symbolic, and it is. Those 10 chariots represent the 10 sephira. King Dasaratha is a symbol of you and me. But only a you and me who is an actual initiate, who has become a king. And what do we mean by a king? We mean a malachim, a melech in Hebrew. Those 10 sephiroth of the tree of life are inside of us. We all have 10 chariots. They are the 10 sephiroth in us, related to our body, related to our soul. Moreover, those 10 relate to our senses, to our mind, to our consciousness. There are many levels of meaning to the 10 chariots. But we're trying to go deep into the inner esoteric meaning, the higher level. Those 10 sephiroth represent our inner kingdom, our malkut. You see, this word malkut, which on the tree of life is the lowest sephira and relates to the physical body, that word malkut means kingdom. Dasaratha was a king of his kingdom. So when I say that Dasaratha represents us, I mean that only as a polite gesture. Because really, none of us are kings or queens of our kingdom. None of us control ourselves. We are under the control of outside and inside forces. We have very little willpower. We have very little ability to determine our circumstances or our future. Because we are so under the influence of our desires, of our ignorance, of our karma from our past actions. We are not Adam in the Bible, who was a king before he fell. We are not Moses, who is a king of himself, a master. We have to become that. Dasaratha in the story represents someone who has become a king, an initiate, a spiritual aspirant who is achieving some degree of sovereignty over his mind and is able to control his senses and his desires as he approaches the path to God. Unfortunately, he has a problem. He doesn't have an heir. He doesn't have the spiritual elements that he needs in order to advance. The reason this is important is because in the spiritual path, even if we don't realize this or we don't like this, we have to die. Death is an integrated part, is a requirement of the path. Psychological death. A mystical death. And for that death to occur properly, there must be a resurrection. There must be an inheritor of our work. That inheritor is the soul, our real identity, our true nature, our Tathagata Garbha, our Buddhata, our essence. The soul that should inherit our spiritual values and all the gifts from God in us. And that all of our terrestrial part and all of our mistakes and all of our desires and cravings and afflictions and sufferings will die. And what goes on is a purity. Our true purpose can be fulfilled. Dasaratha represents that initiate who's at that stage, who needs to go on, but needs that inheritor, the one who will inherit his work, the fruits of his labors, psychologically and spiritually. So he appeals to his family preceptor, to his master, who is, of course, his innermost. And his innermost said, take this payasa and offer it to your wives. This is a very significant scene in the Ramayana. Payasa is rice pudding. Nowadays it's called kheer. It's milk with sugar and spices and rice. It's symbolic. It's esoteric. It represents the sexual energy. It represents the transmutation of our sexual forces. This is semen. Symbolic, pure, sweet to the taste of God. Not bitter with lust, not poisoned by lust, but pure and sweet. This is ambrosia, amrita. This is the food of the gods. The gods give this to Dasaratha and say, give this to your wives, and you will have a son. Not only one, but four. That gift he has to give is his purified sexual shakti. His virya, his virility, made pure, made clean, immaculate, an immaculate conception like Jesus. Not corrupted by desire, by ignorance, by pride, pure as an offering to God. So when he makes that offering, his wives become pregnant. Now he has four wives in the story. And they all become pregnant. Of course, this is symbolic. This is not a stamp of approval for polygamy. This story is symbolic. These wives, his three wives, who have four sons, the three wives have very deep significance in many levels related with our psychology. On the most basic level, they relate to our three brains. They are feminine because they work through Malkut, our physical body, which on the Tree of Life is feminine. It is the Nukva in Kabbalah. They receive the Payasa and become pregnant. They give birth in the 10th month. And this is related with the Arcanum 10, which I'll let you study so you can go deeper into this lecture. 10 is the wheel of life. So his wives are Kausalya, Kaiki, and Sumitra. They have four sons. Kausalya, or Kausalya, has Rama. Kaiki has Bharata. And Sumitra has the twins, Lakshmana and Satrughna. These four sons represent the soul, represent the chariot of Ezekiel, the Sahu of the Egyptians. They represent the chariot that Arjuna rides in the Mahabharata. Here on this graphic of the Tree of Life, we see the Tree of Life with names to explain what these lower Sephiroth relate to in us. The upper three, I explained, relate to the Trinity of the Divine. The lower seven relate to us more directly. The bottommost Sephiroth is the physical body called Malkut, which means the kingdom. Integrated with that is Yasod, which means the foundation. And this sphere relates with our vital body, or the ethereal body. And that is completely integrated with the physical body. You can't separate them and have a life and have existence. So we can consider them one. Next, the third sphere is Hod, which relates to our astral body, to our emotional brain. And the fourth sphere is Netzach, which relates to the mental body, or to our intellectual brain. And finally, the fifth sphere is Tiferet, which relates with our causal body, to our willpower. So these lower five spheres relate to us as a soul, as a human being. And the two above that, Gebura and Chesed, relate to our monad, to our innermost, to our inner Buddha. In us, the exponent of divinity is our innermost. The Trinity above, as we explained in the previous lectures, combines into two, Shiva Shakti, to create through Da'at, and the result is Horus, the innermost, Ganesh in Hinduism. That is Hesed, our Atman, the seventh sphere from the bottom. Our Atman is our innermost, our spirit. And our spirit has a feminine aspect, the wife of Ganesh, which is called Budhi. That's why Ganesh is called Budhi Priya, he who loves Budhi. Budhi is Gebura on the tree of life, which relates to our divine consciousness. In this image on the right, we see Vishnu and Lakshmi seated on a serpent that has five heads. That image represents the monad. It represents how Vishnu Lakshmi work through Atman Buddhi in us. And they do that through five serpents. Those five serpents must be raised in these five lower bodies. Those are serpents of Kundalini. Those are the Shakti of God. In other words, an initiate who's entering into the genuine spiritual path in the internal worlds is protecting, preserving their sexual force. They are in Brahmacharya. They are not spilling their sexual energy. They are following the commands of Shiva given in Shiva Samhita, which state, I, Shiva, am the semen. And Shiva says that that energy must be preserved in the body. That semen is sexual energy in men and in women. That teaching is to not have the orgasm, to waste that energy in animal pleasure, but instead to retain it and make it an offering to God, payasa. That offering, in combination with the spiritual work, the psychological work to purify oneself of lust and pride and anger and envy, results in initiations in the soul. When one passes the trials and tests of those initiations under the auspices of one's own innermost, working as a couple, man and wife, that energy is activated. Those three forces from above work below in the waters of the sexual energy. And that's the water surrounding Shiva and Lakshmi, Vishnu and Lakshmi in this image. The waters are turbulent. That is the sexual water. Turbulent because of too much emotion, too much lust, too much desire, too much karma. But when we are able to be stable in the midst of all that turbulence, sexually and emotionally, in our lives, and retain that energy and give that energy to God, we can enter into this process of initiation. We can raise the serpent of the Kundalini, not once, five times. The first time is the serpent of Kundalini that rises up the spinal column in the physical body. The person who does this receives many gifts, spiritual abilities, but it has to be earned through psychological work, through the merits of the heart, through by embodying the force of Vishnu Lakshmi, Christ, by helping others, by denying oneself and helping others. After that first serpent is risen, one can enter to the second initiation related to the ethereal body. And one goes into deeper tests and ordeals and problems in order to overcome one's desires, one's fears, anger, pride, envy, laziness, gluttony, etc. Step by step, slowly. This process can take years. Once that serpent is risen, we go to the third related to the astral body. In that third serpent, the astral body is created. This means that a person no longer has that lunar mind, the lunar astral body, but a solar one, created from the atoms of Christ. That person awakens a certain degree of consciousness in the astral world. They are able to enter the astral world at will, according to their level of development. They have other powers too, remembrance of past lives, telepathy. Many different types of abilities emerge. The fourth serpent is related with Netzach, or the mental body. And the fifth is related with Tiferet, the causal body. These are the five primary serpents that have to be raised, and it's a long process. Depending on the person, their karma, and their seriousness, it can take years, it can take lifetimes. But it requires three factors in daily activity. The death of the ego is the main one. Daily work to purify oneself of one's mistakes, mistaken ideas, mistaken beliefs, mistaken actions. The second factor is the birth of virtues, to reject those negative behaviors and adopt positive ones for the benefit of others. The third is that, sacrifice for others, to convert one's actions away from selfishness, self-centeredness, towards gratitude towards others, generosity towards others, towards helping others, sacrificing one's own desires and putting the needs of others first. Through that process of those five initiations, those five serpents, a person becomes a human being. An actual human being. That word human, we've explained many times. It is a contraction. Hu is the breath. It relates to the innermost, to chesed. And man is manas, the mind. Hu man is the spirit controlling the mind, or over the mind. The innermost first. We are not that. We don't even know what the innermost is. We've never experienced it. We may not even believe in it. We are not human. That's why when you observe our actions, when you observe yourself, you will see that it is very easy for us to behave selfishly. It is very easy, natural and spontaneous for us to behave in ways that benefit ourselves. But it takes enormous effort to do something good for somebody else. To give up our desire. To spontaneously and naturally do for others. For us, it takes a lot of effort. This shows we are not human. We are animals. Animals with intellect. A real human being is someone who is being in that state of who? Allah, the Buddha. Whose every motion is with concern for others, not oneself. Whose every thought, every emotion, every action is focused on and concerned with the benefit of others, not oneself. In other words, they are spontaneously virtuous. We are not there. And we need to analyze that and recognize that and start to change that so that we can become a bodhisattva. This image of Vishnu Lakshmi sitting on the lotus with the five serpents over them represents the spiritual state of a bodhisattva. Someone who's entering the bodhisattva path. This person is rare. This does not happen a lot. There are millions upon millions of people on this planet who think they are spiritual, but none of them are on the real spiritual path. Because none of them are working on their pride or their lust or their anger or envy, etc. They think they're going to go to heaven just the way they are, and they are mistaken. No scripture in the world says that. Every scripture in the world says, you must be pure. Jesus said, be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. He said, no idolater, no adulterer, no murderer, no thief, no fornicator will go to heaven. Very clear. And we have those elements in our minds, in our hearts, in our bodies. They must be removed. There are people on the planet who are making that effort, learning to meditate, learning to observe themselves, learning to analyze their behaviors every day, to start understanding the root of suffering, which is in our actions, and to start exchanging those mistaken actions for beneficial ones, actions that benefit ourselves and others. But that process is long and is no guarantee that one will actually awaken, because our karma is so strong, our ego is so strong. We need more help than that. We need Vishnu to help us. We need to appeal to a higher force. We need Vishnu to descend and help us, to save us. We need the incarnation of the Lord. We need Ramachandra. So the king gave the sacrificial rice pudding to his wives. They became pregnant and had four sons. Those four sons represent the soul of the solar bodies. Rama represents Tiferet, the causal body, the body of willpower. He represents Christ, who incarnates in us, the human soul, an actual human. In the Ramayana, Ramachandra represents a perfect man. Perfect, not a flaw, not a speck of ego, no pride, no lust, no envy, no fear, no gluttony, no greed. He is a pure incarnation of Vishnu. That potential is in us. That is Tiferet. Ramachandra, the name, literally translated means pleasing moon. Rama means pleasing. Chandra is one of the names for the moon in Sanskrit. Pleasing moon. That name means something. Because we are all in the dark night of a dark age. And we need light to guide us. Tiferet in us can reflect the light of the sun. Tiferet is our human soul, directly in the center of the tree of life. The word Tiferet, translated literally, it's a Hebrew word, literally means beauty. Somewhat like pleasing moon. It's something poetic and beautiful. And you see that when you look at this tree over the body, Tiferet is related to the heart. Tiferet relates with our human soul. And is that place in us next to Chesed, our innermost. And who can reflect that light in us. When we're in the darkness of our lives, we need that light to guide us. That light that comes from inside, through our heart. That light begins in us through intuition, through our conscience, through listening to knowing what is right and what is wrong. That is a power of Tiferet, who's giving the jnana, the knowledge of Vishnu, through the heart. That is what Ramachandra represents. He is the perfect man. That man is not outside. That is our inner perfection. Our complete potential is to become Rama. So the story of the Ramayana is about that. Many people read it and think that he just represents a great guy that we should all try to act like. It doesn't mean that. The story is saying, you can become this, Rama, spiritually. And the whole Ramayana is the story of how that first level person who's entering into the straight path, who has created the soul and passed those five initiations of major mysteries, and wants to completely incarnate the Lord and become a fully developed bodhisattva, they have to eliminate the ego 100%, and you cannot do it on your own. It's impossible. It's too strong. It's too powerful. Not even the gods can remove it. Ravana cannot be killed by gods, spirits, or demons. He can only be killed by a man, and that is Ramachandra. This scene represents when the sage came to the king and said, I need your help. This demon is interrupting my sacrificial rites. This demon Ravana is interrupting my rituals, and I need you to send someone to take care of this demon. The sage in this part of the story relates to our innermost, who's trying to work inside of us spiritually to perform rituals on our behalf, but our ego is interfering. Our ego is interrupting the work of our innermost. So our innermost says to the king, Dasaratha, which is us, you need to send some part of yourself to deal with this ego, because he's messing up everything we're trying to do. So Dasaratha sends Rama. This demon Ravana is depicted here with his 10 heads, his many arms. That is our ego. It is how we, at one time, long ago in the past, were great kings, Adam and Eve, with powers in nature, able to communicate with God, great devotees of God, given great powers by God. But we rejected that because of our pride, because of our lust, because of our envy. We wanted to be better than God. So God, according to karma, expelled us from the garden, or rather we expelled ourselves from the Garden of Eden through our mistaken actions. So this name Ravana means the one with a terrifying roar, but his other name is Dasavarana, which means he of 10 heads. Do you see the duplicity of this symbol? Do you see that Dasaratha, the king, has 10 chariots? And that Ravana has 10 heads? And that they are each other's face? They are the same one. Dasaratha is the terrestrial person who's trying to reach God. But he can't because of his ego, because of his karma, which is Ravana. This represents us, our problem. In other words, we are Hannes Musen. This word represents, or means, in synthesis, someone who has a split gravity, a split identity. Part of us, some portion of us, remains pure and longs for God. That's why we're attracted to spirituality. That's why we have a conscience that feels when things are right or wrong. We still feel that. Many people in the world do not. That connection is severed. They are empty houses. But those who study this type of teaching generally have some connection yet in themselves to divinity that longs for the truth. That is Dasaratha. That is us. The king who wants a son. But unfortunately, the sage, the prophet in us, which is our Abraham, our Ganesha, is trying to conduct rituals to help us, to help our kingdom. But the demon keeps interfering with the rituals, and that demon is our own Ravana. It is our own inner tree of life inverted. If you look at this image that I showed you of the tree of life over the body, you see 10 spheres on the upper portion of the tree, 9 spheres below. In the center is Malkut, so above Malkut are 9 spheres. 10 above, but if that flips, it's 10 below. That lower aspect from Malkut down is hell. Gena, Avicii, Averno, all those different names that represent the lower worlds. That is not outside only. It is outside of us. There are places that are hell. But we are only related to that physical or exterior portion of hell because we have it inside of us. Because our own hell is so populated, so filled with lust, with anger, with pride, with resentment, with jealousy, with gluttony. That is our Ravana. Malkuth below, 10 Sephiroth in us that are inverted. That have all the powers of nature, but inverted. And that result in suffering and destruction. And that interfere with the process of our own innermost trying to help us. So we need Ramachandra to come. Because no one else can kill Ravana. No god, no demon, no spirit. In other words, the only one who can conquer our karma is Christ. And how can Christ do that unless Christ works through our hands? If you understand something about karma, about cause and effect, you understand that any action we perform has a consequence. And that consequence is related directly to the action. That means anything I have done, I bear the consequence for that. No one can take that away from me. It's my own action. It's my own consequence. Whatever afflicts me was made by me. No one can come and say, okay, let me erase all that for you. You can start over. Nature doesn't work like that. There is such a thing as forgiveness, but it doesn't work like that. You earn forgiveness through action, through wiping away those inferior actions by performing superior actions. But some of our ego, the bulk of it, the trajectory of it, is so strong, it's totally beyond our ability to catch up to it. And if you want to see the truth of that, sit back and try to understand the entire situation of this planet. The whole thing, from top to bottom. All of the suffering on this planet, and that every single action in every moment is perpetuating that and growing that. That lust and anger and envy and pride and greed and gluttony and laziness produce more suffering. And every human entity on this planet is producing more and more of that every day. That is a huge trajectory of energy that none of us can overcome. That is Ravana in action. The only one who can overcome that is Christ. So here we see on this graphic these realms. And caught in the middle is the physical world, which is sinking and being crushed by the karma of this humanity. And we observe that every day. Humanity suffering more and more and more. And the ignorance is growing more and more. Those problems that we think we're solving, we often wind up creating more problems with our solutions. So the Ramayana tells the story of how Rama, through a long series of epic events, manages to overcome Ravana and kill him. It's a long story that we don't have time for in this lecture. But I encourage you to read it and study it and understand that it is a cosmic drama. That whole drama is about a relationship between Rama and Sita. Sita is his wife. She represents the perfect woman. But not physical. But the perfect consciousness. In the story, we see that Sita is abducted by Ravana and taken away. It's the same story that we find in all the Greek myths. Eurydice is captured and taken. Helen of Troy is captured and taken. And the maiden that's captured and taken by the dragon that George has to go and conquer. In all the stories, we see this fundamental myth. What it represents is parts of ourselves that have to work in order to overcome our karma. Sita represents Gebra. Sita is an incarnation of Lakshmi. Rama is an incarnation of Vishnu. So the whole Ramayana is about the second mountain. If you've studied the three mountains of Samael and Vior, you will understand what this means. Rama is Heracles, who has to perform many epic deeds in order to overcome all of the problems caused by the demon, Ravana. The end result of the Ramayana is that Rama is able to establish a perfect kingdom, heaven on earth. And this is the theme in every religion. This is the celestial Jerusalem talked about in the book of Revelation. This is the perfect world in which there is no suffering, and all of the inhabitants live lives of complete and utter fulfillment. Many people in the world think that that is an actual physical event. It is not. It's symbolic. It's relating to the celestial kingdom, or Malkut, that we have to establish in our psyche, inside of us, in which all of our inner inhabitants have utter fulfillment, prosperity, and peace. No suffering in our minds or hearts. Instead, we have enthroned in our heart and mind, Rama and Sita, our human soul and our divine soul. And their only goal is to serve God. The entire Ramayana is about a promise that Rama makes to his father. And he has to undergo a lot of suffering in order to live up to his word, because what he said, he lives by. I urge you, I recommend to you, to study the Ramayana, not just as a comic book type of story, but as a scripture. It's filled with important information related to the development of the soul, especially for those who aspire to the straight path. Do you have any questions? Related to the role of Rama, he's explained to be the perfect man. So we should explain that this middle triangle in the Tree of Life, which is Chesed, Gebra, and Tiferet, have corresponding names in Sanskrit. So if you study any Sanskrit scriptures, you'll be able to relate these three spheres. Chesed in Sanskrit is called Atman. Gebra in Sanskrit is called Buddhi. And Tiferet in Sanskrit is called Manas. Manas is where we get the word man. Manas is our human aspect, our human consciousness. It is our actual soul. It is a portion of the spirit. It is his exponent. It is his weapon. In the legends of Arthur, Tiferet, or Manas, is Lancelot. Not the Lancelot of the later writings that made him into an adulterer and a fornicator, but the original Lancelot, who is the great champion who fights on behalf of his lady and his king. That is Manas. That is Rama. Rama is that active component of the consciousness that descends into life in order to fight the demon. But moreover, he represents how Christ descends into us, because there's a distinction here. The human soul is one thing. Christ is another thing. When someone raises the serpent of the Kundalini related to the causal body, that is in the sixth dimension, it is not physical, that causal body is the human soul. It is Manas, an abstract mind. And that mind, that level of our psyche, is our human soul that we have had for eternity. It is our true identity, if we have that. It is that, as an aspect of the being. But we are not that. The human soul is perfectly, spontaneously virtuous. We are not that. What descends into us from existence to existence is a spark of that, undeveloped. It is the buddhata or essence, like a child, like a baby, undeveloped. It is not the full human soul. It is not the complete human soul. It is not Rama. Many people read these stories and read the esoteric meanings and think, I am the human soul. I am the bodhisattva. That is wrong. We have to observe our actual behavior to see who we actually are. And our actual behavior, physically and psychologically, is negative, harmful to ourselves and others. Thus, we are not that. We can become that if we purify ourselves of our mistakes. We can become Rama, spontaneously perfect, meaning that one does not have to make effort to be perfect. We have to make effort. So we reach that level by learning about ourselves. Whether or not we're in the stages of initiation or not, learn where you actually are. Not where you think you are, where you want to be, but where you actually are. And analyze your behavior. In order to understand the human soul, to understand Rama and Vishnu, to understand the innermost, you have to first start with understanding your own self, who you actually are now. And this is a process of self-observation from moment to moment, constantly, never stopping, always questioning and analyzing your behavior. Not only what you do outwardly, but especially what you do silently, in your mind. This is what's really important. Because we all modify our physical behaviors so that we'll look good to others, so we'll get the approval of others, so we look like a saint. But we're all liars. The truth is, in our minds, we are murderers, we are adulterers, we are fornicators, we are thieves. We are envious and jealous and very lazy. Spontaneously, that's just the way we're being. That has to change. Through that self-observation, continually, all the time, observing ourselves psychologically, and then at the end of every day, we review what we learned, what we observed, and we analyze that more closely, more deeply in meditation. But part of that observation and analysis has to also include an investigation of what we should have done. What would have been the right behavior? If we found and discovered in ourselves a moment in which we became very angry, then we need to look at that situation and see how should we have felt and how should we have behaved, and analyze not only how that anger is a source of suffering, but how a sense of love or acceptance in that moment would have been very beneficial instead of harmful. And in this way, we start to comprehend. Do you see three forces there? Three forces. The negative thing, the positive thing, and then we have the equal, the comprehension, the understanding. That is what leads us to really develop spiritually. It is comprehension in the heart, to know it and feel it in the heart, that this mistake should not be repeated. And instead, we need to appeal to a higher force and try to behave better. Through that type of comprehension, our behavior will change naturally. Not through us forcing ourselves or repressing ourselves or defeating ourselves or beating up on ourselves, but changing because we genuinely and truly in our hearts want to change and need to change and will change. That is how we see those six virtues of Vishnu starting to emerge in us. And that is how we appeal to becoming an actual bodhisattva, through our actions. One second. A question back here?
Would you like to comment on the symbolism of the bar of the graphic number 11? If there is a parallelism between it and the bars of Hercules, Odysseus, and the other mighty bows of the many mythologies?
The bow that Rama uses in the story is the same bow that we find in all the other great myths, like Heracles and Odysseus, etc. That bow represents willpower. And that the only one who can bend the bow and direct that arrow, which is power and energy, is Christ. Christ is the only one who can do it. That bow is the very power of Christ to act in the world through his soul. No regular person can move that or harness that force. Only Christ can do it. So that's the meaning. Question.
What is it meant by, of course we go, we have to pay our own karma, but what is it meant when we say we pay karma as a couple, we pay karma as a family, we pay karma as a city, a state, a country, a world?
Well, we accrue, every action corresponds to the performer of the action. So as a group, we are gathered here as a group, and this is an action, and it has consequences, good or bad. So as a group, this is an action. To be together, to work together, to study, to learn, to meditate, that is an activity that results in consequences. That's all that is. But if we gathered as a group to do drugs, or to distribute alcohol, or to convince people to do something wrong, as a group, we would acquire consequences for that action. We may or may not pay as a group. We may pay for that as individuals. It depends. But karma is related always to the performer of the action. So if someone was not here, they would not acquire the consequences or the benefits of what we're doing. Only the ones who are participating get that.
Say in a family situation, somebody think it's karma taking effect in that family?
Sure. Everything that happens is related to previous causes. Whether it's specifically for the family to suffer the loss, it may be. Could easily be that. It depends on the nature of that particular situation and the conditions there. It would have to be investigated. The problem is that the stream of energy that's moving through humanity right now is incredibly complicated. I mean, we can see that just in our own individual life, how complicated everything is, and seems to be getting more and more complicated. But if you start stacking up people and people and people and people, it's incredibly complicated. So there are stronger karmas overriding weaker ones, constant chaos of conflicting events that are unfolding. And in the midst of all that, we have the gods who are trying to help us. Vishnu, working through his avatars, is trying to keep the whole thing somewhat stable so we at least have a few more moments to try to get out of it. But unfortunately, we just persist in making it worse. And at a certain point, the gods won't be able to hold it anymore. It'll get too strong. And the whole thing will collapse. So we have to always be mindful of that. Any other questions?
What is the Kabbalistic equivalent to Mahatma?
The Kabbalistic equivalent of Mahatma. The term Mahatma means Maha Atman, which means a great Atman or a great soul. That term is used in India in the same way we use the English word gentleman, ladies and gentlemen. It's just an honorific term. So there are many people who are called Mahatma who receive that as a title of respect. It doesn't mean that esoterically in the development of their soul, they have incarnated Atman. doesn't mean that. The only one who's going to know if they incarnated Atman is Atman, not terrestrial people, because we're all asleep. So we shouldn't look to find masters based on titles or honorifics, because those are given by terrestrial people. The only way to find your real master, a real Maha Atman, is to meditate and look within, because you have that. Your own innermost is Mahatma. It is your master, your great soul. And if you get to know that, you will know everything you need to know to incarnate that. You won't need anyone physically, externally, no school, no master, no teacher. You only follow God. More questions?
Does the Bodhisattva also renounce the hair? Can the hair absolutely renounce?
Okay, is there a limit to renunciation? Does the bodhisattva renounce Keter or the absolute? A bodhisattva, strictly speaking, is a vessel of the light. How could the vessel renounce its own light? It could not. What the vessel renounces is any dust or oil or grit or poison that is on the light bulb. The bodhisattva seeks to make that light bulb absolutely transparent, invisible, meaning no self, no I, no interference, no prism, no obstacle for the expression of the light. So when we say that the path of the bodhisattva is a path of renunciation, it is a path in which one renounces selfishness, greed, gluttony, lust, anger. In reality, the one who walks the bodhisattva path, it is said that that person renounces everything, but the truth is they acquire everything. And this is what Jesus said in the Gospels. He who gives up everything for my sake will gain everything. Jesus was a great bodhisattva, is a great bodhisattva. And his teachings are 100% pure, not pure now, but they are focused entirely on bodhisattva path. Even though sometimes it's hard to see it because the writings have been so corrupted. But Jesus taught the straight path and still teaches the straight path. He's not a teacher of the spiral path. That's why his teaching is so revolutionary. And on that note, let me explain something about revolution. We talk about Gnosis being a revolutionary teaching, and many of the books have the word revolution in the title. So many people are attracted to this type of knowledge, thinking, I'm going to be a rebel, a great revolutionary. And this is a great enthusiasm. But unfortunately, it's misunderstood. The real revolution is not against the world. It is not against others. It is not a revolution against one's family, one's brothers, one's parents, or one's city or country. It is a revolution against oneself. The real revolution, the Gnostic revolution, is against pride. It is against lust and greed and gluttony. It is against ambition. The real revolution is to become empty so that God can fill us. And the only way you can become empty is to kill Ravana. So we need Rama, the Lord, to descend into us and to kill the demon. And to do that, we have to earn it. We don't earn that by building big groups or by giving millions and millions of dollars. These are helpful. They're useful. But the best way that we can help humanity is to kill our ego. Our ego is the cause of all suffering. The cause of suffering is not money. It is not politics. It is not governments. It is not religions or economics. The cause of suffering is the ego, which is in us. If you want to change the politics of your community, change yourself, not your politicians. You can't change anyone else. You can try your whole life and you will never do it. The only one you can change is yourself. So start there. This is the example given by Buddha by Jesus, by Krishna, by Rama, by Muhammad. To really be a devotee of Christ is to become Christ. And that's not by changing other people, it's by changing ourselves. Any other questions? Someone back? Is the purpose of this lecture to reach the worshipers of Rama and unite these religions? I don't know. I teach what I'm given to teach. I don't know the reason why. I don't ask. I do what I'm told. Any question back here? I think you had a question, right?
What do you mean when you say polytheistic religion?
Oh, polytheistic religion. Yeah. That word is poly means many. And theos is God. So polytheistic would be a many gods religion. So many people say Hinduism is polytheistic. That's wrong. It isn't. It's a religion that sees the many faces of God. It doesn't worship many gods. It's one God. And ultimately, in their root, every religion was like that. The Greek mythology, which displays many types of gods, and also the Egyptian mythology, it's very beautiful. Many types of gods that we see in the Egyptian myth, or the Nordic, or the Aztec. Those practitioners of those religions knew that those are all faces of one God. It's only now that in our ignorance we see those religions, or those the remnants of those traditions, and we think, oh, they were worshiping many gods. It's wrong. There are many people in their ignorance who assume that, but it's not true. Maybe later on, as they degenerated, yeah, people worship many gods, but that's a degeneration. The actual true religion recognizes God is one. God is light, spiritual light. But that light emerges as billions of colors. We worship all the colors, but it's one light. So that's what we study in Gnosis. The polytheism of the one. Which is beautiful, and it's important because we all have our own psychology and our own idiosyncrasies. So some of us relate well to certain forms that God shows us. Some might be attracted to the Jewish form, or the Christian form, or the Egyptian form, or the Hindu. So we try to show every form is the same. And by comparing them, we can fill in the gaps of things that were lost. Christianity's lost a lot of its tradition, because it's been so edited. So when we study the other traditions, especially the Jewish tradition that Christianity came from, we can see what Christianity really means. And the same is true of Buddhism. To really understand Buddhism, you have to study Hinduism. Because all Buddhism came right out of Hinduism. That's why if you look at that chart of the avatars of Vishnu, one of them is Buddha. Vishnu was first. Buddha came later. So to understand Buddha, you need to understand Vishnu. Was there another question back here? No? No more? Yes?
The Divine Mother, in the Hindu pantheon, was she corresponds to Kundalini?
In the Hindu pantheon, the Divine Mother also has many forms. The whole tree of life is her body. She is the Prakriti, she is nature. So everything that exists is the Divine Mother. But when she needs to create spiritually in us, then she needs her exponent to be present in us, and that exponent is Kundalini. And that energy works through energy centers in us, beginning firstly and foremost with the spinal column. She works through the nervous system, because that's where we get all of our energy, all of our potential to be alive is in the nervous system. It's in the spine. So she is that energy. In us, she is static. Latent, not awake, not active. But in a spiritual aspirant who's actually harnessing these forces and working with them, she awakens degree by degree. And we call that Kundalini. And it has many levels, many degrees. It's not just, some people mistakenly think that if you do a million repetitions of a particular mantra, that that energy will awaken and you'll be a complete master right then. That is a complete falsehood. Nothing in nature works like that. Everything in nature grows slowly according to a process. And the soul is especially like that. It's a long process. So she, as a force, as Shakti, awakens in us through that energy that we call Kundalini. And in the Bible, it's called the fire of the Pentecost. So when the apostles in the book of Acts received that fire and the flames appeared above their heads, that's a symbol of that fire of the Divine Mother. That's awakening them and giving them the power to act. That is the Shakti, the power. Yeah. And she is that. She's the force of the Mother, the creative power in all things, who loves all things. She wants to benefit her children. She doesn't come into our bodies just to let us show off and act like masters and try to get a lot of followers. She doesn't want that. She wants to save us from suffering. So if she's going to incarnate in the body of a person, it will only be in a person who will use her energy according to her wishes, which is to serve others, to help others come out of suffering. What else does a mother want? She wants to save her children. Any other questions? Which moon images? The question is about moon images being in the form of a crescent. In Hindu images, we often see a crescent moon in relation with Shiva or other gods. The crescent moon represents the moon that is emerging out of darkness. And that moon is what reflects the light of the sun. So it relates to spiritual development. In other traditions, in Buddhism, for example, they often show a full moon. This one has a crescent. But generally, it's just a symbolic meaning. Deeper than that, there are esoteric teachings about the moon, but we don't have time to go into that today.
Can we successfully annihilate a piece of our ego and be unconscious of it?
Can we unconsciously annihilate a piece of our ego? Never. The only way to overcome the ego is to be cognizant of it. The ego itself is unconsciousness, subconsciousness, infraconsciousness. It cannot be eliminated automatically by paying somebody money or without your knowledge in any way. Like I said before, any action you perform corresponds directly to you. This is why if you have an ego, it's something that you created and only you can eliminate it. But unfortunately, so much of our ego is so powerful and so ancient, we don't have the power or the skill or the consciousness to do it. We need the help of God. So God will incarnate in us if we reach the level of being a bodhisattva and work through our human soul together inside of us to guide our actions to overcome that ego. But that is a fully conscious process, completely cognizant. You cannot conquer an ego unless you know about it. How are you going to stop acting lustfully unless you consciously understand that lust is harmful? You won't stop behaving that way automatically. It can't happen. You have to be aware of it. For example, if you buy a new pair of shoes and you start doing your work and going here and there, and then you start feeling a lot of pain, but you don't become conscious of it, you're just going to keep going. It's only when you realize, oh, these shoes are hurting me. They're hurting my foot. I need to take them off. Then you can be helped out of that suffering when you become aware of it. The same is true of the ego. It is constricting us. It is binding us. It is hurting us in many levels, but we have no cognizance of it. So we just go right along not aware. Conditions may change, so the pains might change. But the ego will not be eliminated unless we consciously, cognizantly see it and change it. This whole work is like that. There are many people who assume that they've reached the third degree of major mysteries and that they have their astral body. But they don't know it. Those people are lying to themselves because of ambition or fear or pride. Or they assume that because they stopped looking at pornographic magazines that they no longer have lust. That's also a lie. Because if you change the conditions physically, that ego may not be coming up in the same way, but it's still there. An ego is only eliminated and destroyed when you've done it consciously yourself. When you have cognizantly comprehended it in your heart and mind. Now the students are looking very pale. But this is the truth of this work. It does not happen on autopilot. It doesn't happen because we're a sincere student or we really mean well. It doesn't happen. You might really want to go up to the top of the Empire State Building. You might really long for it, but you will only get up there if you walk, if you do it yourself. Your friends might go up and come back and say, oh, it was like this and it was like that. And you might ask them a million questions and you might really memorize and picture everything and think, yeah, I really know what that's like. And now I can go tell everybody else and tell them how great it is up on top of the Empire State Building. And everybody else might be convinced that you went, but you never did. There are a lot of Gnostics like that, who talk beautifully about the astral plane, about going out of the body, about awakening Kundalini, about talking to Jesus or another angel or master. They've never done it. Or they talk about how you got to do this and that to eliminate an ego, and they have never done it. Let's not be those people. Let's be sincere with ourselves. Be honest. Know what you know. And if you don't know something, come to know it. Make effort. Yes.
What can one do if one cannot understand what would have been the right thing to do in a situation in the retrospective meditation?
That's a great question. What does one do if you can't understand what would have been the right thing to do when doing a retrospection type of meditation? You keep meditating. The answer is to use your imagination. The ego that we have and the habits that we have are very old, very difficult to comprehend because they feel like our true identity. We've been carrying them around so long and fattening them up for countless existences. It's very difficult to see ourselves as we really are. And when we want to see what would have been the proper behavior, use your imagination. Let your imagination teach you and guide you. If you're a great devotee of Jesus and you're meditating on an ego that you saw during the day of pride and you really felt arrogant and you saw how you acted in a way that you shouldn't have acted, you said things you shouldn't have said, maybe you hurt someone's feelings, maybe you put someone down and you feel bad for that and you want to know, what should I have done? Then pray to that deity that helps you. If it's Jesus, you pray to Jesus, please teach me and show me, what should I have done? And use your imagination. Imagine Jesus coming and teaching you and telling you and showing you. And let it come as pictures and let it come as words and analyze what appears to you. Because it may not be Jesus giving you the message. It might be your ego. You have to have that discrimination inside to analyze the things that you work with. But by practicing in that way, cognizantly aware of yourself, little by little, that type of technique can open the doors to an actual experience with Jesus or an actual experience with Moses or Krishna, whoever it is that you're asking for help from, or your divine mother. Those experiences can come as a flash. They can also come as a long drama or a dreamlike series of images or sounds. There are many types of manifestations that can emerge through this type of practice, and they will teach you. That is how you gain comprehension. You won't get it through reading books. You won't get it through talking to your friends or asking others. I know that nowadays many people who are really wanting to know about themselves and longing to learn about their psychology and get frustrated with meditation start turning to psychological books, pop psychology books, New Age psychology books, like this stuff about the Enneagram. And they start thinking that that's real knowledge. And it isn't. What we have to realize is that that pain in the heart of not getting fruit from meditation And that frustration that comes when we've been meditating and meditating and not getting an answer, that pain, that suffering is important. Don't avoid it. If you're feeling pain and frustration from your meditation, stick to it. Because that pain and frustration is an ego who is suffering. It is an ego of pride. It is an ego of ambition that wants to compete with others, or that wants to outdo others, or that wants to be somebody. When you feel that pain and frustration in meditation, or you feel like, I'm not getting it, I need to comprehend. What you need to comprehend is that feeling. Turn your attention to that feeling, to that impatience, and meditate on that, because that's the real obstacle. Meditate on that. Any other question? Okay, thank you.
To learn more about what you learned in this lecture, we invite you to explore the books published by Glorian Publishing, available from booksellers worldwide. You may also be interested in online courses or upcoming retreats, all of which you can learn about at GnosticTeachings.org. All of this has been made possible by the financial support of listeners like you. Will you help others to benefit from this knowledge? Most spiritual schools recommend a donation of $10 to $20 per lecture. Every donation helps. Make a donation now at GnosticTeachings.org. Thank you. May all beings be happy. Amen.